Thank you, Louis. It's good to be back. I'm just curious, how many of you were here for the presentation back in? Okay, so we have a number of new folks. Well, I have built upon the previous presentation. So at any point, if you have questions that aren't covered, please understand that we can go back and I can fill in the blanks for those of you who, one way or another, haven't gotten the some of the foundational concepts. But I'm trying to build on what has happened since October 25th, when I was here last. And I do want to thank you for coming on. It's always special to be back. Invited back a second time, you're never quite sure, you know, how you've been received, because I do have a point of view. I try to be objective, but the struggle for our community has really been to try to find the meaning of a consensus about this mega project, this infrastructure decision that's going to impact this for decades. And decades, frankly, when I, at least, and if you perhaps won't even be here to see, you know, how that all rolls out. But it is about the future of transportation in Syracuse in a larger context than simply what's going to happen to the viaduct that goes through the center of our city. So here we have it.
Turn the light off.
Built back in the 50s and 60s, you know, I don't know all the history of it, but that's not so important as understanding that it has to come down. Its lifespan is 2017, and guess what, we're here. And I left in my car, I meant to bring in a bolt that I picked up when I was walking on a tour underneath the viaduct, the things that are falling off it, right? And the DOT has an emergency crew that's available 24 hours a day in case some of that concrete does fall and, you know, they need to patch things up or do whatever they do in an emergency. It's at that critical stage. Now, those folks who say, well, we can just patch it up, this is an unrealistic option. Even though if you go to the DOT website, you'll see that they have the no-build option, that they have to compare any other proposed alternatives against. But essentially, they have said that if our community can't make a decision, if we can't have emerge an answer that is going to be acceptable to whoever's making the decision, we'll talk about that later, then they will reach a point where they'll just have to close down I-81. So any of you who's still thinking, well, they can just keep patching it, that's just not a viable answer. So what's happened since I was here last? And Governor Cuomo came into town in January. And despite the fact that in last October, the DOT team, the project team, had rolled out in an accelerated pace a narrowing of the alternatives to either rebuilding the viaduct in a choice of, I guess, three viaduct options and the choice between a community grid. There were two community grid alternatives. So we knew kind of what we were expecting. We were expecting in early 2017 that the DOT folks would complete what's called a draft environmental impact statement. You'll see a little bit later how that process works out, but essentially it's a funneling process whereby they keep assessing different factors and trying to come up with the best alternative. And then in this draft environmental impact statement, at least we were led to believe that they would say which of these two alternatives would get their blessing and move on to public comment and then move on further unless there was some adjustment to it into a final environmental impact statement, which would be really the DOT's recommendation to the feds for a discussion. Because why the feds? Because they've got the money. Governor Cuomo said, no, you know, this hasn't been going quite the way I see it should be going, because there's all sorts of political rumblings. I'll explain that in a second. And we're going to hire a consulting firm out of New York City. And so we've got WSP Parson Brinkenhoff Consultants. They're paying them $2 million to essentially revisit what the DOT had done, but, very big but, the tunnel alternative now becomes something where the governor's perspective is it needs more detailed design review. It had been eliminated in October as being one of the alternatives that the DOT folks in the state would move forward in a much more detailed study. So why is this all occurring? Well, Senator DeFrancisco, did I spell that right?
Yeah.
He held a forum. This was I wrote a critical review called A Night at the I-81 Theater. And the politicians didn't appreciate it, but it was very much orchestrated by the senator in terms of bringing out a parade of persons with perspective. And I'm not questioning the sincerity of any of those perspectives, but it was an orchestrated presentation. It started at 6 o'clock and ended at 10 o'clock at Henniger High School. And essentially, these were representatives of interest groups who felt that if the interstate wasn't to continue to go through the center of Syracuse, it would have disadvantages for their communities or a negative impact on their community. People from Cuyahoga County, people from Skaneateles, people from DeWitt, of course, people from the northern suburbs, they were all ringing in with the fact that they viewed the DOT's status at that point had not fully appreciated all of their concerns. Now, frankly, all of those concerns had been heard. But when you organize a political constituency and you put allies together, it makes it appear as though there's a very large bunch of folks who need to be listened to further. So the governor, who does this dance with Senator DeFrancisco anyway, because he's such an important person in Albany, and on the Republican-controlled Senate, at least, makes all sorts of financial decisions. And of course, then there is the New York State budget, which ran over a little bit. But so one's got to wonder if Governor Cuomo might assess his decision to delay this whole process if, in fact, he didn't have the New York State budget and all the related issues together. But that's the larger, you know, picture. And it's a little hard to draw any immediate conclusions from that. But that's where we were. So the consultants have been hired. And that leads me to a more reflective mode, Easter Sunday. So I was up on Burnett Park Zoo. St. Lucie's has a sunrise mass. That's a picture from the sunrise mass. I always find that experience to be very, and especially this Easter, because it was nice and warm, but hopeful, you know, the sense of resurrection And of course, in the religious season that we're in, the Passover as well is the recognition that people have been liberated from oppression and so forth. So it's a positive perspective. However, driving home back to the east side where I live, I had to go under the viaduct, and I looked at the viaduct, and my wife was driving, and I said, oh my God, am I going to live long enough to see the completion of this project? I mean, really, that it was an existential question for me. I've been involved with this thing for 4 years. I never anticipated becoming a transportation expert of any kind, because as Lewis had indicated, my background is in end-of-life care, but that's a whole other perspective, and maybe it's the perspective that helps me keep a forward-looking, because I do tend to raise hope up as an important value for me, and what I mean by that is to have a vision that's beyond the existential question that you might feel in a more imminent way, and understand that, particularly we as senior citizens, that the things that we're involved in are going to have an impact beyond the years that we're here on this earth. So, but it's still a struggle for me to see how this is getting dragged out, and knowing that the tunnel alternative would probably involve, after a decision is made, which maybe by the end of the year, another 10 years. Anyway, I do want to raise a question of hope here. And I also want to remind you that this decision is being made in a larger environment of transportation evolution. Along with the state budget, Uber was finally approved. What's going to be the impact of Uber in Syracuse? It theoretically could change the landscape in a great way. Particularly younger folks are saying, well, I'm not going to buy a car. And so if they're not buying cars, that means there's going to be fewer cars on the road. The Syracuse Metropolitan Transportation Council right now is studying the question, and I'm sure they will come with a positive outcome, about whether to seek the investment in bus rapid transit. Bus rapid transit will make commuting and just traveling along these two routes that they're studying something much more attractive to what we call choice riders. You know, we've got the folks that have to use the buses because they don't have vehicles, but the choice riders, many of you who may be in the room here, are folks who they hope to draw into the bus traveling population that says, oh yeah, the bus, if it's rapid, if it doesn't have as many stops, and if it can go through and change the lights, the green and red lights, then I might find this more to my liking for commuting or for whatever reason. But there are other things going on in the transportation realm as well. So I did want to point out, so what else? Here's the DOT project process. And I'm sorry you can't see the but essentially at the end of October, the viaduct of the community grid were what was going to be studied in detail, and that was going to come out in this report. So the tunnels had been dismissed at this stage. These were the finalists, tunnels had been dismissed. Now we're really seeing a looping back, and we really, the DOT's been pretty silent on this, in part because maybe they aren't even in the loop in terms of what this consultant is doing. I hate to think that, because our own local technocrats here have been gathering a lot of information for a long time. And I'd like to think that the New York City-based consultants, I assume they've come to see Syracuse, but, you know, they may be sitting in their little cubicles doing engineer stuff, I don't know. I would assume that they're focused on this and not trying to rethink the whole thing. But it remains to be seen exactly how broad their charge was.
Well, sooner or later, these $2 million dues are gonna have to come forth with some information.
Yeah.
An opinionated information.
One would hope. So, tunnel options, while we're at it. This is the Miami tunnel. It was on their website, the consultants that were using. And here are the three tunnels. I wish I could have copied the maps, but they'd still be so small, you wouldn't necessarily be able to make out the direction. But we're talking about a tunnel that's gonna be north-south, of course, and T5 replaces the viaduct, that's coming down. And then there would be a shallow 2-mile tunnel under Amon Street, starting at about East Kennedy and going to Butternut Street. So essentially, the tunnel would be...
You say Kennedy Street?
Starting there at East Kennedy Street. It's a southern street, so it would start in the south, and then it would run to approximately Butternut Street on the north side.
Remind us again where Kennedy Street is in reference to Adams.
It's south of Adams.
So the project south would be around south.
So the tunnel would start...
Near the project.
It'd be from south of Brick Road.
Yep. So this is one alternative. And T6 would replace the viaduct with a deep tunnel west of Amon Street. Essentially, this would be going under Townsend Street. It would start at Martin Luther King East and then once again come up on the north side.
Martin Luther King
Street is where Castle.
Used to be Castle, thank you.
I don't know why they're changing the names of all the streets.
Yeah.
Well, that's something else.
Yeah. And then T7 would replace the viaduct with a deep tunnel. And now, let me distinguish a deep tunnel from the two previous ones. This is what I've learned. With the particular topography of Syracuse and the existing infrastructure under the street, Syracuse, essentially they dig a big ditch where they'd want the tunnel to go. And then they'd install the tunnel and then they cover the tunnel. So it's cut and cover approach. So if you can envision a construction of a big ditch in the center of the city going on for years. You've got the picture. And then the deep tunnel would really be to bore up underneath all the soft stuff that otherwise is in that basic corridor.
Okay. Does that mean that all of the houses and everything in its path is going to be demolished?
Well, I'm getting to that. First of all, I want to just highlight how Moving People has come along with its judgments. Why a tunnel is a bad idea? There's really no discernible cost-benefit assessment for the local economy that would justify $3 billion. That's what the tunnel alternatives would be, $3 billion, as opposed to the community grid alternative, which is $1.3 billion. Still a lot of money, but this essentially would cost we, the collective taxpayers, or whoever it is that would end up funding this a lot more money. Yes?
I'm a little confused. If they did tunnels, would they be three tunnels or they would choose one particular tunnel?
Just, well, the engineers, the consultants that they're using would presumably look at the three alternatives that were, see, they started out with something like six tunnels.
They're crazy.
So just to understand, the three tunnels that I just quickly reviewed for you are up here. But they had four tunnel alternatives up here, so they dropped off one and they had these three remaining. And now, the question will be, when they bring forth their draft, or their consultant's report integrated into the draft environmental impact statement, whether one of those will be chosen as the preferred, or whether the consultants will be recommending to the state DOT that they need to make a judgment about the consultant's report. Whether the consultant's report and all its detail will be available to the public, I don't know. But in other words, there's this sideshow over here where they're essentially going to be digging, sorry for the pun, digging into the data to try to figure out whether or not one of these three that I just briefly reviewed would be a viable thing for the DOT then to take more seriously in its overall assessment, because this is not just about engineering factors, it's also about the socioeconomic impact on the whole community of any one particular alternative that might be brought forward as the preferred one to take to the next level.
Is 690 supposed to be tied into these somehow?
The tunnels don't tie into 690 directly. No, that's also one of the kind of the confusing questions that come up in terms of, because essentially this is going to be something that's going to promote through traffic through the center of the city. Yes, sir.
Okay, there's one comment I'd like to make before you move away from the tunnel aspect.
Yeah.
I've never seen or heard anything about the possible physiological aspect of people who have claustrophobia. Now, you've heard of people who will not drive through tunnels. There are people who will never take an elevator. There are people who are terrified of the possibility of being in something that's enclosed. Now, let's assume there's a family in North Carolina or South Carolina. They want to go to Canada. They look at the road map, they say, oh great, Route 81, let's go to Canada. They may not know that when they go through Syracuse, all of a sudden they have a 2-mile tunnel.
Right.
What if part of that family is claustrophobic?
Yeah.
They could easily have an accident in that tunnel.
They could be in trouble.
The guy's driving.
Yeah.
Because it's, I don't know what percentage of American population is affected by that. But I've never seen any discussion where this might possibly have come up as a as an alternative.
Of course, I'm assuming if a tunnel prevailed as the alternative, that there would be more than adequate signage.
Warning sign.
About the fact that for people going to Canada from Portland or wherever, that they would take 481 and pick up 81 north, north of the city. But that's a serious concern. I mean, we see what a small railroad bridge in Liverpool Parkway can do to people's sense of disorientation. People don't necessarily always make the best judgments.
The problem with Kennedy Street and Castle Street, Martin Luther King Street, is tying South 81 going north to those streets. You're gonna deviate into the city before you get to a tunnel, which doesn't make any sense.
Well, if the tunnel would maintain the interstate quality, so people that want to go north of the downtown area would enter the tunnel, they wouldn't get off at Colvin or Brighton?
No, if you're going down 81, going north.
Yeah.
And you're at Adam Street.
Yep.
At some point, your 81 is gonna stop, and you have to go over to whatever street is.
Well, you wouldn't get that far. You'd already be in the tunnel at Adam Street.
Which locks out anybody.
Yeah. The tunnel has to.
Going to the university or the hospital is at that point.
Well, what happens with the tunnel, people that wanna get either that downtown or the hill or, would be using the street grid.
Well, the way I look at it is if you did a tunnel, connect it with 81 where Adam Street is, have the exit for Adam Street, but have a tunnel going down right before, so they're both on 81 and one goes down and one goes to Adam Street, and you just go through the city.
It won't happen that way.
That, to me, makes the most sense.
Yeah. Well, they're not gonna try to replicate the interstate above the surface. That would become a street.
No, but at some point, they have to connect to the original 81.
Well, that would be on the north side. That would be on the north side.
Well, the north side, originally, 81 was connected at Hiawatha, and 81 stopped around exit 16 before they built 81 for the viaduct in, I think it was 68 or 69 when it was completed.
You've got more history than I do.
I grew up going 81, or going around 11 up north, so I knew when they connected it, 81 to South Salina Street going south, and that was when you got off and it connected to 690 East. And then they started building the rest around it.
Okay.
Just one quick.
Yes.
Were there geological issues with regard to tunnel system as far as groundwater and necessity to pump?
Yes. Those are the factors that this consulting group are charged with assessing the utility, if you will, of a tunnel. And that's why I said the cost benefit assessment of what it would take, and that's why it would take, cost $3 billion. They'd have to essentially rearrange the plumbing in the city. And, well, that might be some benefit to the city because our water infrastructure is a serious concern. But let me just continue with a few comments about why the tunnel is a bad idea. It would severely disrupt the fragile economy of the city of Syracuse. You know, if we had that construction over a 10-year period, it's a little mind-boggling to me that the folks on the periphery of the city wouldn't understand how detrimental, from my point of view, that would be to the ongoing economic revitalization of the center of the city. And it appears as though a tunnel would be a marginal benefit to our two largest employers, the university and the medical center. And there, here's where the whole title called environmental justice comes into impact. The southern entrance would involve the city's south side in a way that it would have negative consequences and really continue to separate the south side from the rest of the city just because of the, at the entrance itself. And you see the kind of, not only all the concrete and other materials that are necessary under the ground, but there would have to be venting and other kinds of structures that are part of the tunnel in the way it functions, because the air needs to circulate and they need to move elements like water and snow and so forth through all that.
So essentially, it's gonna be like the big dig in Boston, but on a smaller scale?
Well, that's one way of seeing what the future might look like. The folks, I've been consulting with the folks on the north side, which includes St. Joseph's Hospital, the Salina business folks, the folks in Franklin Square, and so forth. And they are very concerned that the tunnel would be very detrimental to the whole Little Italy and redevelopment that's been going on right along the corridor that comes, the I-81 corridor that comes out of the the city. So, just to remind you about what the community grid would do to deal with traffic wanting to go to the Hill or to the medical centers. It would not be along Adams Street for the most part. Traffic coming from the west would get off at a new interchange at Irving and travel off of 690, which would take you right up to the Hill. Folks coming from the east, such as Manlius, would get off at a new interchange at Kraus. Once again, it would go directly south to the Hill. And they are redoing the Teal Avenue interchange, so that becomes another alternative, particularly for folks coming from the eastern areas in terms of going wherever you need to go on the east side. So, Anna Ryan, who's in the back here, has put together this nice chart. I'm sorry it's not quite big enough to, but you can see comparing the three alternatives, community grid, which is the first, well, it's the second column, 1.3 billion, viaduct 1.7, and then the tunnel being 3.1. Properties demolished under the community grid would only be five. Viaduct, we take out more properties in the city, 24. And with the tunnel, it's real indefinite, but 10 to 15 to over 100. I mean, it's hard to imagine what that kind of enterprise would really look like. And then we're dealing with the time frame, the two community grid and viaduct, those two alternatives, 3 to 5 years, and then the tunnel would be a much more extended period, maybe up to 10 years. And of course, the annual cost is fairly minimal for the first two alternatives. And you've got now ongoing costs in terms of the maintenance of the tunnel that wouldn't be present for the other two. And in terms of the kind of auxiliary elements, street lights and the first two alternatives, and then you've got pumps to
power the fire engines.
Pumps to remove water and fumes into the air and so forth. So this is just a nice standby alternative here. So who's going to decide when? Well, you know, people say, well, Destiny USA is going to be making this decision. I certainly hope not, because while I respect the fact that Destiny USA is a very, very important economic resource for our community and generates a lot of sales tax and other things, who knows what's going to be happening with malls, even if they're a special designation. Politicians, you know, unfortunately, we see a little bit of an alignment of politicians, particularly with the state legislators, and I don't know what that's all about. We are undergoing leadership change in the city of Syracuse. We've got 10 candidates for mayor. So, how they are going to involve themselves on the ongoing debate and what influence that they'll have over the next several months. But by November, we'll have a new mayor. The technocrats, you know, will the engineers win out? And, you know, somehow miraculously save us from ourselves with, you know, their expertise. Here's the alternative. I'm hopeful that the people will come forward and inform all the policymakers. And in that sense, it's really about a big policy. The question being, how are we going to solve this dilemma?
Aren't you missing the check writer?
Well, and here's the wild card in the whole process. And with all due respect to President Trump, he's got some ideas about how to fund infrastructure projects that are going to be, even though there should be a bipartisan approach to this, he's got some notions about using tax credits as opposed to funding come from Congress, which means that, you know, for instance, we could have a toll tunnel. You want to go through the tunnel, then you're going to have your little, you know, your see-throughway, whatever that thing is, that clocks onto your Visa card. So, a lot of, you know, and what's happening in Washington, I don't need to tell you, there's enormous question marks there about how, whether Congress is going to work with the president to get anything done. So, yes, sir.
Yeah, could you review again, who hired the consultants? How much does it cost? Who's paying for them? Did anybody set any target dates with them?
Good question. Apparently the contract, a couple of million bucks, which in terms of consultants sounds like jump change. I mean, a lot of money in my mind, but they're essentially to review all the work that the DOT has done and then add their particular expertise, because they are the tunnel people. They build tunnels all over the world.
Who's paying for them?
It would be in the state of New York, and it's taxpayers. And I'm sure there's a federal share and all that, but I don't really know the details of how the contract. And, you know, I continue in dialogue with all these folks. The DOT people are folks, State 81, and we're all kind of in the dark in terms of how this is going to roll out. I've been on the stage here with a number of other people, and everybody just.
Where can we see schematics as to where, how each of these are supposed to work?
Well, you'd have to go back to a website called I-81 Opportunities. And the I-81 Opportunities would present what's called the final scoping report. The scoping report was where they look at everything and then said, well, we've got to narrow the search. But there they got their preliminary assessment about why they dropped certain alternatives from going forward and narrowing the field. So you know, depending on what your perspective is, they've got too much information or not enough. You know, if you're an engineer, you're going to want to see the schematics on how that's going to be clear. So
does the schematic, would the schematic have an overlay? Doesn't matter, but you understand, first place, you understand what a schematic is? Yes. It's a layout. It's nothing more than a layout.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, well, right. I mean, I'm speaking to you as a lay person in this whole field, but, you know, trying to accumulate as much information that I can share to a lay audience. But, sir, yes.
There's one name I'd like to throw out that I'd be interested to know if he's been involved in any of these discussions, because I've always trusted his judgment and knows a lot about the area. His name is Tom Young.
Uh-huh.
What's going on?
I haven't heard anything from Tom Young. Yeah.
He was involved with local, state,
sure.
State fair, city.
Well, the other person who is highly experienced with the city is now the Commissioner of Transportation for New York State, and that's Matt Driscoll.
Yeah.
So we're assuming that Matt, with his intimate knowledge, if you will, of the way our community is put together with its neighborhoods and its competing interests, if you want to put it in those terms.
What are you hearing from him?
Well, you know, Matt's still a politician, even though he's a commissioner. And he's taken his marching orders from the governor. So, my hunch is that the governor, this is a stalling tactic of the governor, that he wanted to get the folks that wanted a tunnel off his back. So they had been saying, and we had supported Save 81, because they're the primary movers behind this, who represent Destiny in the northern suburbs, that we thought the tunnel should be fully explored, because from the folks that I relate to, we think the tunnel is totally impractical and would be, you know, a disaster, you know. It would not serve the best interest of the common good, if you will, but it certainly serve certain interests.
Unless you can find somebody who's going to write a check for the 3 or 4 feet.
Well, yeah. Yes.
Have they made a projection? They must have done this. Have they projected the total additional traffic volume on 481 if the community grid concept was implemented, of traffic being northbound, north southbound traffic, actually, that would have stayed on 81, that now route would be routed on 481. And that problem drives the resistance among other political entities of the town of DeWitt, for example, which is worried about the effects of that greater traffic volume.
Yep. The estimate that sticks in my mind is 10 to 12% of the folks going using I-81 through the city and not stopping in the city is so what 10 or 12% of the total volume is, I don't have
that small.
Yes. Because I-81 essentially is used as a commuting lane for people coming from the in 690, of course, into the city, because this is where the largest places of employment are.
Are you saying, Peter, that only 12% of the people that are going, that are using that viaduct, are going from point A to point B and never using the city as a get-off spot?
Well, yes.
Did you say it's all been using 481 since they built it?
No. This is 10 or 12% of the traffic using I-81 to come from, say, Cortland to go to Watertown or wherever. Yes, Diana.
So it's 91,000 is the total traveling motorists through 81. They figure about 12% of that will be diverted. You know, they bypass, so it'll get diverted on 481. That comes to out to be about 11,000 cars per day. It's important to note that of all three options, the community grid is the only one that has in its $1.3 billion planned to expand 481 and Route 90. The other two have no plans for expansion, and they will divert traffic with the viaduct about 5 years with no expansion beforehand to accommodate extra traffic. And the tunnel will take between 8 and 10 years, and you'll have that diverted traffic for the entire time with no improvements to the route ahead of time. So the community grid, for the first 2 years of its construction, will actually be constructing 481 and 90 and expanding them to take the excess traffic. And then the next 3 years, which is when you will have diverted traffic, will be spent on constructing the grid.
That's a very important thing to think about.
Keep here.
Well, let me just repeat. It's all about how the DOT would sequence the various elements of their deconstruction and reconstruction of these highways. For instance, they decided to separate out the Teal Avenue rebuild to do in 2017. They separated it out from the whole I-81 project so that they can have that in position. That was before they even decided on these additional interchanges at Krause and Irving. But what Diana's highlighting is the fact that with the community grid alternative, the sequencing would put an early redevelopment of the 481 structure to accommodate the changes in demand on that road and the way in which the interchanges work there. And there wouldn't be the need, presumably, to reconstruct or redo any of the 481 things if, in fact, I-81 is going through the center of the city.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, costs will obviously change as the years go by, but what is the present, what is the present estimate of the three projects in billions of dollars?
It's 1.3 billion. So essentially, community grid is less than half of what the tunnel cost would be.
To supplement what Peter said, the grid, the loop, is 1.3. Rebuild the viaduct is 1.4. And the tunnel is 3.4.
He just said that.
Yeah, but he didn't. There's a little change of pricing between the grid and the rebuilding.
Now, one actor that I didn't mention in terms of the whole array of politicians and other folks is John Katko. So when he seems to be tilting toward an alignment with Senator DeFrancisco, and you've got to read that he is trying to be sympathetic to the elements that Senator DeFrancisco has orchestrated into this set of allies in terms of bringing their own interests. And of course, he represents the broad area as well. He's going to be influential because in a congressional role where funding goes through, he's going to influence that. So he needs to hear from people about what, how they think the whole process should go forward. He'd be a critical person, and of course, he's up for re-election in 2008.
Peter.
Yes.
What other cities have been looked at, not the metropolises, but average American cities that have gone through this same process?
Well, to the best of my knowledge, where you have aging bridges and there's isn't the need to maintain a bridge, the bridges have been brought down and made into street grid alternatives. So. I can't name the classic example is Milwaukee that brought down an interstate in the downtown area. And
one city that comes to mind, personal experience, is Columbus, Ohio.
Okay.
That they had straight through, and then they built the arterial, but they never took down the straight through.
To assess how Syracuse would compare with these other communities' decision-making, I think you'd have to know more about the specific circumstances. I know there was, in Providence, Rhode Island, for instance, interstate was brought down, and they've had, I mean, one of the things that the people of Syracuse in general, and I would hope the larger circles, indicate that if this land was available through the community grid process, that we'd see a lot more the value of the land between downtown and the university would skyrocket. Because now, not only is the viaduct depressing any kind of value for the land underneath it, it's not a great insight, but the land adjacent to the interstate essentially is grossly undervalued for properties that would be in the center of any vital city. And once the viaduct is gone, presumably people will want to see business and residential developments in the center of the city that'll be close either to downtown or to University Hill and the medical center.
Yes.
With a street level I-81, at least you wouldn't have the problem they have in Atlanta with somebody building a fire and having the bridge come down.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that because one of the things that some commentators pointed out was even though this big fire that essentially destroyed some lanes in the interstate there, guess what? People are inventive. They find new ways to get to go where they need to go, and there wasn't any huge congestion in terms of the things that people might anticipate.
Immediately after.
Yeah.
Because actually I was just with someone this past weekend from Atlanta, and it's gotten days now. Government official actually is. Because there were fewer people traveling because they knew the damage.
Okay.
but they used alternative routes for a day or two and found that those were not convenient for them because of the time required, et cetera.
Yeah.
And so they have tried now to use routes near to where the actually the interstate was.
Okay, well, that makes sense.
The problem with street level is going to be the foot traffic and the bicycles getting across it. And then people walking and taking the bicycles wanting to go on it.
Yeah, we have somebody here who hasn't spoken.
Remember the movie that asked the question, show me the money? Who's going to be, who's going to assign the contractors in either case? Where does the influence come?
I got to assume that the whole question of who's going to get contracts is something that the state DOT would be determining.
I'd like to know who the contractors are connected to.
That's
the question, yes.
Well, that is.
I remember our baseball diamond and the discussion of where that should be located.
I think the other question is, whose system is going to get gored? Why is Senator DeFrancisco got this love affair with tunnels?
That's right. Big
question. Who is going to benefit from, I understand this completely, okay? That's been my mantra for a little boy, okay, I understand that. But I say, who is going to be the beneficiary if the tunnel becomes a reality?
That's right.
Okay, and why is this senator have this love affair with the tunnel? Who is going to enjoy that decision?
Well, that's sort of interesting, Lou, because San Francisco, or Senator DeFrancisco, used to be a fly in the ointment and an active opponent of the casual destiny.
I understand that.
So it sounds like he's somewhat, for whatever reason, flipped here. But has Destiny provided any sort of projected numbers as to their possible diminished business if the community grid concept was implemented? Because it sounds like the primary opponent are that and certain other north side interests who are afraid that the ease of access to their commercial facilities will be radically interrupted and it'll sharply diminish their business. So then the question is, are there other potential road projects which would replace or facilitate such access if the community grid? Because 481, as you know, intersects 81 up
further north,
mm-hmm. and then people would then have to come south down to the.
We make a loop and come back.
Right, right.
Let's go back to the first question. Who will benefit from the tunnel? You say Destiny will. I say Destiny will, okay? But DeFrancisco, and this is going to sound terribly political, says it doesn't matter. Isn't that what you're reading? That's what I'm reading. He won't admit, and this is terribly political on my part, he won't admit that Destiny is behind this force. I don't know what Peter thinks.
I think it's, with all due respect, too simplistic just to blame Destiny USA. I'd like to do that myself. But there is a whole enterprise in the town of Salina, in the northern suburbs, that feels it's going to be negatively impacted. And that Senator DeFrancisco may live in the city, but he represents the northern suburbs. So I think he's, in that sense, responding to the broader set of constituents that he has. Not that I think he's at risk of losing his job. You know, he's been in office for 10 years, and yes.
So, I'm totally ignorant, but just repairing and rebuilding the viaduct, That seems to be the last choice.
It's no choice.
No choice.
No choice.
Because you gave a price for that, which was, maybe I didn't.
The price was, oh, rebuilding the viaduct is $1.7 billion.
Yeah, but the.
But it would have to be torn down and rebuilt according to certain safety standards that are now placed for highways.
Why is that the, seems to be the last choice? We're discussing the grid, the tunnels, why?
Well, it's still in play. The rebuilding the viaduct is still in play.
I think getting a modified, it would be better than the other two.
Well, there are supporters of rebuilding the viaduct, not one of them, but there are supporters.
Using the same infrastructure.
Well, the modifications.
No, there's, it would.
The tunnels could work if you link them to going north onto 81 and hook them up to 690 going east and west.
Yeah, that's not gonna happen though with the tunnel.
Are we to assume that 690, the elevated part of 690 to Syracuse is safe for quite a few years? Or does that have to come down too?
It originally was a train tracks.
The DOT just last year had to rebuild the concrete on a portion of 690. I don't know if you remember that. They were actually very expedient with their process, but they did it because the rebuilding of those elements of the bridge, actually a lot of 690 is a bridge. And if you know the history, I mean, it was an elevated.
Yeah.
Right. Anyway, so that's why in 2017, from Beach Street all the way to Teal Avenue is gonna be rebuilt. That's all bridge, that's viaduct there. You can't really see it, but that whole section is gonna be rebuilt as part of the process of redesigning the interchange at Teal Avenue. We're hoping a roundabout will actually go into the Teal Avenue interchange, actually two roundabouts, one with the post office and one that would interact with the interstate. So we'll see.
And the state has already started to buy up some property north of the 690 passageway from Beach Street to Thompson Street. Didn't I understand it?
No, that acquisition of land has to do with this changes to 690, not 81 yet.
Yeah.
Although the I-81 folks who have improved properties along the northern stretch out of downtown are really very upset because the current plans call for an expansion of lanes, which would really push I-81 literally right at your window if you're in one of those businesses that have rebuilt those properties. You know, there's some great new properties along, particularly on the west side of I-81.
Another caution with the tunnel, the pumps that the gentleman up the front had said was remove the water that gets removed is brine, and therefore must be disposed of as wastewater. So the tunnel is going to have wastewater disposal that needs, it has huge air exchangers to take the fumes out and get oxygen in to the tunnel. And its maintenance costs are $10 to $13 million more than the other two options per year. And that maintenance cost grows. So by the end of the life of the tunnel, the gap, the difference would be like more closer to $20 million per year for the maintenance cost of the tunnel.
So you expand it for 50 years and you're into the billions of bucks.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a
to
build
brine, salt, metal. So I want to thank you all for your attention and your good questions. And if you want to communicate with us or be involved with moving people, please just.